Lulabach.
Lulabach.
Three syllables.
See, I'll remember that.
Hello, welcome to this week's Legislative Update. I'm Jim Baumgart, one of your hosts, and Nanette Bulabash is the co-host of the program. Welcome to joining us to talk about historical things on history and Sheboygan County. We have with us today the new Director of Development, Stephen Rogstart, from the Historical Research Center. And thank you for coming. Yeah.
Thank you for having me.
As I've stumbled through the introduction, but that's a busy place you have there in Sheboygan Falls. You have a program that you're putting on that's going to be some exciting things we'd like to talk about, and you produce books and help people with their genealogy and countless other things. So thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me. Yes, the center is a very, very busy place, and it's busy in a myriad of different ways, which you've identified some of them. And I like to think of it as the main source of historical adult continuing education in Sheboygan County. I think we do a fantastic job with that.
That's so great. What is the most important thing you want people to know about the Sheboygan County Historical Research Center?
We are vibrant. And we are active. And I wouldn't want somebody to put the center in a box and think that all it does is house documents and images, which we do, of course, 1 million documents and over 500,000 photographic images. People think of an archive as a very dusty, rather unexciting place to be. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't, and the people that are there don't think so, but that's not all that this center does, and it is so involved in the community with a number of community outreach programs that I find those fascinating, because all of them, for the most part, are somewhat based on the information that's housed in the center.
That's fascinating. I have to bring up these, but you told me before we started that the center publishes 4 or 5 books a year.
Correct.
In addition to all your programs and people coming in and you helping individuals do their own genealogy, family history, building history, business history. It's fascinating. But these books, this is, I don't know how new this is. From Bootlegging to Brothels, Sheboygan County Vice During the 1920s and 30s. Now that's a
Isn't
book
that a
I
great
would
title?
Pick up. I love that title. And you said Beth Dipple, your executive
Beth
director,
Beth Dipple,
wrote
our executive
this.
Director,
Using
wrote it.
Photos, archived documents. If you want to know about brothels, go to the museum. Who knew? The sausage that made Sheboygan famous, the rise of the bratwurst. Well, of course, that's our pride in Sheboygan County. We've got, and not just Johnsonville, but several companies. Long, long, rich history. It is what made Sheboygan famous.
Right.
And this one, Stories Told in Granite and Glass, about churches?
And cemeteries. And memorials and monuments in the greater Sheboygan area.
Which are fascinating places to visit. So.
And these are fantastic books. We have a bookstore.
We're talking about
more action in the building than you think. We have a whole bookstore. And people can come in there and buy books for birthdays, anniversaries, Christmas.
So good gifts.
Great assortment of literature.
It's right in our backyard. That's what fascinates me. It's not D.C. It's right here. Sheboygan County is full of stories.
Absolutely. Fantastic stories based on the books that you'll see in the bookshop.
Yeah. Well, and some of them have been people that were in World War II that took pictures, and years later, they decided that they didn't want it lost just to their families. They wanted everybody to understand the difficulties and interest of one soldier going through World War II.
Right.
And a number of them have written, some very well written, some basically writers who just wanted to get their information out, but a whole range of books on cheese factories and one-room schoolhouses in the county.
Education.
We have a volunteer that has written books on his father and soldiers in the Korean War. He's working on another book right now.
Hmm.
At the second Saturday lecture series, for example, and you mentioned World War II, a lot of people do not know that we had aircraft carriers on the Great Lakes of World War II for the practice of the planes coming in. And so we actually have a speaker coming in to speak on that.
Yeah, right.
And so we have all this wonderful history that's not lost, but our job at the center, and the job of everybody really, is to preserve the stories, because that's what makes up the history. Because history is storytelling, primarily. Before we had the written word, we had people telling oral history, and those were the stories. So, but we have some phenomenal talent in the greater Sheboygan area. And I also wanted to tell you about a couple of exciting events we've got coming. One is August 16th and 17th, the center is sponsoring a two-day historical symposium this year. And the theme is going to be history and travel. And the idea is, once you go to the symposium, I want everybody so anxious and excited about what they heard that they're going to get in their car and go and see these things that they heard about for 2 days. So we're going to have 8 different speakers coming in over 2 days, and we have lectures on and presentations on circus history, the Indian Native American effigy burial mounds in the area, Civil War sites in Wisconsin. I'm going to be doing the Lincoln sites in Wisconsin, lighthouses in Wisconsin, just gangsters in Wisconsin and popular sites associated with the gangsters of the 1920s
and 30s. Okay, I have to take you back. I know that you are a Lincoln scholar. That's your passion. You spent years speaking about and leading tours on Lincoln. You just said Lincoln in Wisconsin. What are Lincoln's ties to Wisconsin?
Well, he was here twice.
He was.
He was here as a 23-year-old militia soldier in the Black Hawk War, and he was actually mustered out of service up by Whitewater, Wisconsin. And there used to be a great big handmade large white billboard that was painted. Now they've put a much more more impressive marker there. But Lincoln was mustered out of service near Whitewater, Wisconsin.
I don't think people
know
that.
And then he was invited back to Wisconsin in 1859, the year after he debated Douglas, and he spoke at the Wisconsin State Fair, and the only time he ever spoke on the subject of agriculture. And he spoke at 13th and Wells in downtown Milwaukee, which you can find a marker there for that. And if you go to State Fair Park in Milwaukee, you got to look between these poplar trees, but you'll see another bronze marker commemorating Lincoln at the State Fair.
Lincoln was here.
Yes.
Oh, that's
and he was also in Janesville. So if you think about the Tallman restorations, Lincoln spent the night at William Tallman's home there in Janesville and spoke, and also spoke in Beloit in a building called Hanchett Hall, which is still there. It's the only building left in Wisconsin that Lincoln actually spoke in, and there's a tablet on that building. So we have direct ties to Abraham Lincoln here.
And you are, I believe, hosting some programs on Lincoln coming up this year?
We have two that I'm really excited about. I've been coming up every year for the last 6 years doing what we call the Lincoln Seminar. And it's every Tuesday in October, first 4 Tuesdays in October. And this year I'm going to be doing it on Lincoln artifacts. I have to weave stories about Lincoln through artifacts and sites that maybe people have never seen. And so that's what the class is going to be about. And equally exciting for me is the fact that this September 17th through the 20th, we're going to be doing a 4-day bus tour through personalized tours to Springfield, Illinois. And I'm going to kind of go along as the traveling historian, as I call it. I did this years ago for Wisconsin Public Radio, and I'm going to do it again for the center. And
Kathleen Dunn.
Yes, and we're going to be seeing some places that other bus tours that go to Springfield. You'll see things on my tour that you're not going to see on other tours.
Okay.
So I'm really excited about it. But the bus tour, the symposium, some great events coming up, in addition to our History on the Move lecture series, and we also have the Second Saturdays lecture series, genealogy classes. So when you're talking about it being a busy place, it's a very busy place, but it's not necessarily always busy in the center. We're all over.
Right. You're not just a building.
No.
The building is just the stopping point. You're
right.
Everywhere. That's
we're everywhere. Yes.
That's exciting.
But while we're at that subject, one of the things that at some point you'll need to do is to have another building to hold all the material that you're gathering now, and you're sort of making the boards creak because you've got so much, and you're going to get more
stuffed,
over time.
I guess.
Well, for example, yes, you're absolutely right. The center is stuffed. It is that would be an appropriate term. It is stuffed. And just in the last couple of weeks, we received two complete collections. One is a week's collection from an architectural firm, which has 16 drawers, if you can imagine, 16 drawers of blueprints. From 1905 through the 1980s, 471 drawings. Now those all have to be, you know, preserved, cataloged, and stored.
You focused your last newsletter on that.
Yes.
Weeks, W-E-E-K-S.
Correct. And then the Balford Funeral Home recently donated to our center their records, which is in 50 some volumes, all of their funeral records from 1899 through the 1970s. So again, if you think of shelf space and you think of 50 volumes just for that collection, or where do you store 16 drawers of architectural drawings? And they have to be stored in the right way, in the right environment, climate controlled. Yes, it doesn't take long to realize that the center's in its 35th year. Yes, we're stuffed, and I think that within the next few years, you'll probably be seeing an endeavor towards building a new building.
And that's part of your job as development director, is to encourage people to
please. Well, absolutely. Help us. And you know, people always think development is just going out and raising money. And I think there's a misnomer in that, because people are always much more supportive when they know what it is they're supporting. And so for me, it's not just doing the obvious thing, which is raising money for the center, but equally important, if not more important, is raising awareness and making sure that people know who we are, what we're doing, what are we, you know, how active are we in the community. And you have to be able to identify that, and then you have to articulate that and really convey that adequately, which I think is equally my job as well as soliciting for funds. So I'm excited about it. It's a great deal of fun, great people to work for. You know, I couldn't be happier with this.
And I would imagine you're pretty much given a direction to go to and a plan, and then you're pretty much left on your own to get it done. I mean, with the help of
Well, nobody does anything alone, and I certainly don't. Everything is a team approach.
Right.
We sit down and we map out our strategies, and we map out what it is, our goals for the year, and it's always a team approach, but certainly I have things to do.
We have to end it there. I do want to thank Stephen Rockstead for coming today, Director of Development with the Sheboygan County Historical Research Center. We wish you the very best, and
thank you.
Hopefully
and come back.
I would love to come back.
And maybe do one on Lincoln.
I would love that too.
Right.
Until next week, this has been Legislative Update.